I have the pleasure and the honor of introducing our next speaker, Dr. Stephen Treon, someone who really doesn't need an introduction to a WM audience, but I'm going to give him one anyway. Many of you know him because you've been a patient of his. Last year, he saw over 1,000 WM patients at the Being Center at DFCI. And when you think about how few of us there are, that's an absolutely incredible number. If you've not been a patient of his, and if you've ever come to an EdForum, you've heard him speak. And if you've never come to an EdForum, but you've read The Torch, you've probably read a summary of his research. And if you haven't read a summary of research, if you generally read journals like the New England Journal of Medicine or Blood, you may very well have read an article that he and his team have written. If you're on the IWM talk list, you probably see people all the time responding to questions. Dr. Treon told me, Dr. Treon said, and often people will think, what would Treon do? And so I think everybody here probably knows something about Dr. Treon. Late last year, there was a buzz on the a buzz about Dr. Treon's announcement that he was no longer going to be seeing patients, and a lot of sadness because so many of us have come to rely on his wisdom as a clinician for our treatment. But when I started thinking about it, I realized that because he's no longer going to see any patients, he is going to have all of his time to devote to finding a cure for WM. So he's doing research full-time now, and we're that much closer to a cure because of it. Dr. Treon?
Hello, hello. Thank you very much, Michael, for that kind introduction. I just wish my teenagers were all here to listen to your wisdom. So, I think many of you are acquainted with at least the image of Jan Waldenstrom, who back in 1943 was responsible for a publication that first described several patients who had this disorder. But there was a lot of controversy as to exactly what Waldenstrom's entailed, whether or not it was a bona fide disease or some type of clinical syndrome. And it was only in 2002, when we had the international workshop on Waldenstrom's that took part in Athens, Greece, we were able to come together with a firm definition for this disease, in fact, validating it as a formidable clinical pathological entity. And you see here the celebrations at the closing ceremony, where I think most people were just afraid not to end up setting a fire each other as they held these Olympic torches given to us by the Olympic Committee in Greece. Now, in terms of the treatment of Waldenstrom's, I think it's probably best summarized, you know, to date as a hand-me-down disease, where we've looked really to our colleagues who have been treating myeloma patients, those that have been treating CLL or lymphoma, and, you know, we very much like this cartoon, you know, hope that they can actually validate their drugs so that we can then get a chance to use them. And sometimes this delay can be quite long. I think the longest I've waited is almost 5 years for a drug to be able to get vetted out in another disease in order to be able to then be, you know, handed down to us. And you can see with, you know, all these different drugs that we use, their origins really have been in other diseases. And the problem when you end up trying to borrow a drug from another disease group to use in your own is that many times you'll end up seeing side effects that weren't seen in that particular disease. And, you know, this is what we've come to learn as we've been developing drugs for Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia. Even the innocent drug Rituxan that, you know, has been so well utilized across all different types of lymphomas as well as non-malignant conditions, when we finally started giving into Waldenstrom's patients, we saw, you know, particular side effects. like the IgM flare, which we can see in up to half of patients with Waldenstrom's. And if your IgM is very high, it can trigger a hyperviscosity crisis. In some cases, when the IgM goes down, it can make, you know, patients who have neuropathy because of their Waldenstrom or cold agglutinins or cryoglobulins even worse. And the other problem that we're seeing more and more is as we use these drugs, you know, we can also deplete out the good immune cells. So one of the problems that we now face is when patients have been on maintenance therapy for long periods of time, you know, their good antibodies, the IgA and IgG, can come down, and these patients can then be, you know, subjected to various risks of infection. And the other important attribute is that, you know, since Rituxan is part mouse and part human, the other problem that we face from many patients is that they develop also an allergic reaction. With nucleoside analogs that I think many of you are familiar with, like fludarabine and cladribine, we've seen secondary malignancies. With various IMiD drugs like thalidomide and Revlimid and pomalidomide, we've had, you know, side effects like more neuropathy or even potentiation of the IgM flare that we didn't see, you know, in these other disease groups. And then finally, even bortezomib or Velcade, in our experiences, we've seen far more neuropathy than we would have seen in patients with myeloma, and this leads to a high discontinuation rate. And the reason why I put all this out to you as a starter is to recognize that it's important for us to be able to develop targeted agents for Waldenstrom's. And that's why, you know, it was important to take a new direction in this disease. And after all these years since Jan Waldenstrom had first described this disease, you know, we really had very little to say in terms of what its cause was that would then give us the kind of hints that we needed to be able to develop targeted therapies and therefore not only be more on mark in terms of killing the Waldenstrom cells but also sparing the patients of these undue toxicities that they were subjected to all these years because we borrowed drugs from different disease groups. And in order to accomplish this, we set out to do whole genome sequencing. This was actually, at the time that it was initiated, you know, quite an endeavor because the ability to select patients, to be able to get, you know, highly purified DNA for this study, but also to have the informatic background to be able to decipher, you know, the code that goes with whole genome sequencing was quite vast. And just to recognize that each cell that we have has over 3 billion DNA molecules. And all those, you know, can code for different things. And if you recognize also how much variability there can be between two individuals, let alone, you know, many individuals, then you recognize why the informatic part to this was so critical. And in order to be able to make better sense of this, we also recognize that since, you know, the tumor that came from a particular patient may have a particular signature, we also set out to sequence that person's normal DNA to then compare their Waldenstrom's DNA. And this kind of signature was very important ultimately in being able to define the most common mutation that we found in patients with Waldenstrom's. And that was the mutation involving the L265P mutation in the MYD88 gene. This, by whole genome sequencing, in the first 30 patients that we had sequenced, 27 out of those 30 had the mutation. Therefore, 90% of the individuals were found by whole genome sequencing to have this particular mutation. And what happens here is a very simple thing. You see this flipping of this one nucleotide DNA molecule, you know, out of 3 billion in one cell. Think about it. Just one of those nucleotides mutated, flipped over out of 3 billion to be able to cause this kind of, you know, chain of events. And we then went on to confirm, you know, by another technique called Sanger sequencing that we really were on the mark in terms of identifying this mutation. And the good news is that since this paper came out in the New England Journal of Medicine, you know, there have been a lot of groups that have been engaged in trying to understand the role of MYD88 mutations in Waldenstrom's as well as the precursor condition IgMMGUS. You'll see here all the flags. I mean, this very much shows you what kind of interest has now been generated in understanding Waldenstrom's and, you know, subsequent to this also developing therapeutics. And by using various techniques, DNA detection techniques, you'll see, in fact, in the column here where it says WM, that in fact, you know, the overall detection rate of this mutation has ranged anywhere from about 85 to 100%, depending on what kind of technique you use and also the kind of tissue you use. You know, some of us have selected out the B cells, the Waldenstrom cells, and then went out to see if the mutation was present. Some people just used, you know, the entire bone marrow. And this has been why there's been some variability in terms of the percentage of individuals that have the mutation. But probably using the correct technique, you know, and the correct sequencing, it's probably closer to 95%. Not only do Waldenstrom's patients have the mutation, but also if you look at the precursor condition, the IGM-MGUS, with the more sensitive technology, it's probably in the 50 to 90% range for the mutation being there. And what this is telling us is that the MYD88 mutation is probably an early mutation and probably an early driver of the pathology associated with this disease. Now, what's been a boon from this has been diagnostics, because, you know, up to very recent times, you know, you would end up getting a pathology report that would say, well, this person might have Waldenstrom's, but they might have something else, like marginal zone lymphoma was quite common. And so, you know, the nice thing about having a unique mutation or one that's actually predominantly seen in the disease is that you can actually use these kind of, you know, this kind of technology to actually separate out these particular disorders. And these things, by the way, that you're seeing are called violin plots. And what we're looking at here is the amount of MYD88 that's being detected by this technique. And actually, the lower the numbers actually mean that there's more MYD88 there, because the machine doesn't have to cycle as much to find MYD88. And so you can see here the cluster of all the Waldenstrom cells right down here, the Waldenstrom's patients. 93% of them in this particular study had the mutation, whereas when you look at marginal zone lymphoma, very few of these individuals actually had it. When you look at myeloma patients, they didn't have it. In CLL, only one out of about 40 patients had the mutation. In IGM-MGUS, you see that there actually are a few patients that actually have the mutation, but at lower levels. And those that actually had the higher levels of MYD88, those patients went on and became Waldenstrom's patients. And in fact, a very nice study out of Italy confirmed, in fact, these findings, and even suggested that if you have IGM-MGUS and you have the MYD88 mutation, you're more likely to evolve to a malignant disorder, most commonly that of Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia. Now, the other potential boon for this finding is that we might be able to now start shifting away from having to do bone marrow biopsies. I know that many of you will be disappointed by this news. But this is actually a groundbreaking study that just came out in the journal Leukemia from our group by Leanne Zhu, who actually, you know, embarked on trying to develop a more sensitive technique for being able to detect the MYD88 mutation. And in fact, what you're seeing is, once again, those violin plots, you know, for patients with IGM-MGUS comparing their bone marrow MYD88 findings to their peripheral blood. The same for those individuals with smoldering Waldenstrom's, which is asymptomatic Waldenstrom's, those with symptomatic Waldenstrom's, and here with patients that have been treated. And what you'll recognize is that these signatures are almost the same, with a very, very high sensitivity, that you can actually take blood from a patient, pick out their B cells, and actually detect the MYD88 mutation. The ones that actually fell a little bit short, interestingly, were those that were previously treated, because the drugs that we use, like Rituxan, often deplete out, you know, B cells in the periphery. And so even despite that, about 70% of previously treated patients could be detected using this particular technique. And one of the reasons why we're also fired up about this is that you can also use the count for MYD88 in the peripheral blood to be able to separate out individuals that have IGM-MGUS versus those that have Waldenstrom's. And so what we're hoping as a result of this is to be able to transition, ultimately, the field so that even a peripheral blood, you know, test can help us in making the diagnosis of Waldenstrom's, but also may be important in allowing us to track the disease more accurately than IgM. And if you think about it, I just gave you an example of Rituxan causing the IgM to go up. Wouldn't it be nice to be able to tell that patient whether their disease is really progressing or if they're experiencing an IgM flare? And this becomes really critical to us because as we run clinical trials, you know, we often see these rituxan flares, and it becomes confusing. Is the patient really flaring, or is the patient, you know, showing progressive disease? And so these kinds of advances in molecular technology will help us answer these questions. Now, as I mentioned to you, you know, Waldenstrom's is probably a disease where the early driver is that of MYD88, but there are probably other things that have come along to help propel the disease, you know, forward from that MGUS state where the MYD88 mutation exists. And this is actually the findings from Zach Hunter, who performed the whole genome landscape study and had a nice plenary paper in the journal Blood in December, in fact, showing you all the other genes that are involved that may, in fact, be helping the MYD88 and cooperating with the MYD88 to allow the Waldenstrom cells to grow and survive. I clearly don't expect you from your distance to be able to make out all these other gene mutations, but suffice to say, the kind of effort now that we have in place is to try to position these mutations to try to understand how they affect the growth and survival of the Waldenstrom cells and how they can also contribute to the diversity in responses to the chemotherapies that we give patients with this disease. The other way we're also going about understanding this, you know, cooperativity that could exist between mutations is by studying the MYD88 mutation in these transgenic mice. And the IWMF Canada has funded these efforts, which are taking place at our institution under the guidance of Ruben Carrasco, who is probably considered the preeminent authority in transgenic mice. And so we've actually put the MYD88 mutation along with the normal MYD88 in mice. These mice have been expanding, and now what we're doing is we're following them to see, in fact, you know, what the kind of malignant turnabout will occur, and in doing so, then study the cells in those particular mice to understand what other mutations may have been acquired that allowed the you know, disease to progress. These are actually multi-year studies. I always caution people not to expect too much too fast. In fact, it's probably about 3 to 4 years before you end up getting enough data to get excited, but these are the kind of transgenic mouse situations that allow us to define most of the important genes that we know of in malignancy. Now, the other important turnaround for the discovery of MYD88 in Waldenstrom's is to try to understand its signaling pathway, because this is where we can exploit these kind of findings to make targeted therapies. And first and foremost, you know, MYD88 has a role in a signaling pathway that's important for infections. And so normally, you know, our immune cells, and the Waldenstrom cell is a type of immune cell, would be normally surveying the landscape to see if there are any bacterial or viral infections. And typically how they do that is they try to study the particles associated with bacteria or viruses. They're actually components of the cell wall of bacteria and viruses that these sensors actually can pick up. And one of them is actually endotoxin, which I actually spent, you know, many years doing my PhD thesis on. So it's kind of interesting to see how these things can come around, you know, once again to be useful, you know, that kind of knowledge. And so when the sensor is triggered, it actually causes a whole stream of signals to occur, the most important of which is this thing called NF-kappa-B. So you can see NF-kappa-B here. And NF-kappa-B is one of the most powerful growth and survival factors for immune cells. And so if you can see here, these are actually Waldenstrom cells. And what you're seeing here, these blue, you know, big blobs that you see here are actually the nucleus of cells, these blue blobs that you see. And inside these cells, you see all these little green lights. Well, this is NF-kappa-B that's in the nucleus of Waldenstrom cells, turning on all the machinery to allow the cell to grow and survive. And so if you use an inhibitor of MYD88, what happens is that the lights go out, right? Do you see here the MYD88 inhibitor being used? You no longer start seeing, you know, the green lights fluorescing in the nucleus, because now they're stuck out in the cytoplasm. And this was actually the figure that I think finally convinced the New England Journal, you know, medicine editors that this was a good, you know, paper to accept, given particularly the high rate of, you know, the mutation being found in Waldenstrom's patients. And up here we're seeing is the BCWM1 cell line. Here is the a line from Steve Ansel's group, which is the MWCL1, and you see the same exact thing. And so in my lab, Guang Yang, who I have to say is probably one of our biggest friends to the Waldenstrom's cause, because no one works harder than Guang to be able to study the signaling pathway. And he comes with a really, really rich background to be able to do so. And so Guang was trying to figure out how this NF-kappa B actually gets turned on, because if we now know what the circuitry is that turns on NF-kappa B, then maybe you can actually go about making drugs to poison the circuitry or inhibit it. And so there are two major pathways, or two highways, that actually we discovered are critical for NF-kappa B. The one is the very well-established Iraq pathway that's been understood for many years because of what we know from the native or unmutated MYD88, you know, work that's been done. And so when the sensors on the cell surface of the Waldenstrom cells, you know, trigger, MYD88 comes together, it triggers these Iraq proteins, and ultimately these turn on NF-kappa B. But Guang also discovered that Bruton's tyrosine kinase, or BTK, which is the target of the ibrutinib drug, which we'll talk about in just a second, was also turned on by MYD88. This was actually a very crucial finding, and it was based on very meticulous molecular science that he was able to do in the laboratory. The long and short of this is that he showed that MYD88 can bind to the activated form of Bruton's tyrosine kinase, and if you actually use the ibrutinib drug in these cell lines, you could actually block the Bruton's tyrosine kinase from binding to MYD88, and therefore short-circuit this particular system. And he also went on to show that if you could knock down MYD88, you know, you could also accomplish the same, and very nicely, in a very selective manner, he was then able to show that Waldenstrom cells, you know, that were exposed to ibrutinib also showed very selective tumor cell killing. And so this gave us really the background to be able to develop and advance the ibrutinib drug. And as many of you know, this is a oral pill that's taken. It binds to and inactivates BTK, and it's a 24-hour drug, so you actually have to take it once a day. And overall, it's been well tolerated. I'll show you some of the data, you know, that actually goes with this. And this drug has also been in study in CLL as well as mantle cell lymphoma. And so we initiated a clinical trial based on this data. The nice thing about this clinical trial is with the science and with the results I'll show you, the FDA actually gave us breakthrough status. And it will be sometime, I think, you know, later this year, hopefully that, you know, this will be before the FDA. But in the meantime, the data that I'll show you also allowed the NCCN, which is actually a national guidelines group, to actually adopt the use of ibrutinib for patients with relapsed and refractory disease. This is why, as you had heard, you know, it is now possible to be able to prescribe and for many insurers to actually cover the use of ibrutinib in patients with relapsed and refractory disease. And so what I want to do is just move forward and just tell you a little bit about the clinical trial. You know, this was a trial of 63 patients. The trial took place at Memorial Sloan as well as at Stanford and at our institution. And the patients that were on were actually relatively sick patients. You think about the fact that they had two prior therapies, you know, coming into the study. The median IgM was 3,600. The median bone marrow involvement was 70%. And, you know, most of the patients also had enlarged lymph nodes and spleen. So even by a clinical trialist point of view, this is a pretty sick population of patients to take on. These are the reasons why the patients needed to be treated, and no surprise, most of them, you know, needed treatment because they were anemic and symptomatic. And so this goes to show you now what the outcome of the trial has been. This is the data that we reported at the American Society of Hematology. In fact, what you see is a very nice and very robust decrease in the IgM levels for patients that occurs in a very short period of time. Even within 4 weeks, you know, most of the patients have already shown, you know, their response. And with this, which I think is even more important, because a lot of drugs can make the IgM go down and make you feel good, but I have never seen really a drug that can actually make the hemoglobin, you know, go up so rapidly within, you know, 4 weeks to have the patients coming back with, you know, tremendous improvement in their hemoglobin and with that, you know, their function. And again, very unprecedented to see this. And with this also, you see decrease in the bone marrow burden. The one caveat that I just want to say, and I think this is really important for all of us to hear, is that for many patients, you know, the degree of change in the bone marrow disease burden is modest. And despite that, they can still have these, you know, increases in hemoglobin and decreases in IgM. And so this is telling us that there may be other mechanisms, maybe perhaps, you know, cytokines that are made by the tumor cells or in reaction to the tumor cells that also are part of this, you know, anemia that is associated with patients with Waldenstrom's. And so that bears more study. But it also tells us that, you know, ibrutinib is not a cure. For a lot of patients, it's going to probably do a good job for them, make them feel better, even maintain their disease. But we still need to figure out why these cells are still surviving and what we can do in terms of combination therapy or the introduction of other drugs that can affect the same pathway where we can get even further traction. This shows you actually the overall response rate associated with ibrutinib. You know, in this relapsed refractory setting where the patients had an average of two prior therapies, it was 83%, with two-thirds of the patients, you know, having achieved a major response. And more importantly, even at 9 months, almost 90% of the patients were on therapy. So this is giving us really a better signal than we have seen with so many other drugs in the relapsed refractory setting. Now, I just want to show you this slide also, because this is actually now part of our own update. So what I'm showing you here is the investigator response assessment as of this month. You'll see the response rate is a little bit better than what we reported at ASH, but that's not the reason why I'm showing you this slide. I'm showing it to you because I want you to see the type of patients that were treated and what their outcome was. Whether the patients were relapsed, meaning that they had been treated and the disease came back, or if they were refractory, meaning they were treated and they didn't respond to their last therapy, the response rates were the same. And if you look at the lines of prior therapy that the patients had, whether it was one prior therapy, 2 to 4, or greater than 4, you know, the response rates were the same. And this really, I think, speaks very loudly to the fact that this represents a truly targeted therapy for Waldenstrom's. Overall, the tolerance to drug therapy was good. There's some interesting, you know, nuances of the drug, like neutropenia, meaning the white blood count going down, or thrombocytopenia, the platelets going down. But by and large, these events occurred in patients that were heavily pretreated, which really sums up the case that this is a good drug, given its efficacy, to try now for us to move it to the upfront setting and even see it as a first-line therapy for patients with Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia. Now, in the second part of my talk, I really want to focus in on, you know, the question that I asked or suggested earlier, which is to try to understand why the cells are still alive in so many patients and why not everybody gets these robust, you know, ibrutinib responses. And so for that, I want to credit, you know, resoundingly my colleague Zachary Hunter, who was the first to describe and discover these mutations in the CXCR4 gene that Irene Gobrill earlier talked to you about. These were actually, you know, we were able to discover these really squarely because of Zach Hunter's informatic ability. Because when we do whole genome sequencing, as I mentioned to you, it's a very complicated process, you know, with a lot of informatics. And the current algorithms that are available out there fail us many times. They actually tell us there's no mutation there when, in fact, there is a mutation there. And that's why many times these things get missed. And it really was because of Zachary's prowess that we were able to discover the CXCR4 C-terminal domain mutations. And in fact, fairly common. Almost a third of patients with Waldenstrom's have these mutations. And if you look now in his slide, which actually could project a lot better, there's over 30 of these mutations that have now been described. It's not just one type of mutation. It's multiple different mutations that can affect the CXCR4 gene. And each one of these types of mutations can confer a different kind of clinical presentation. And this was a paper that we had in the journal Blood recently, looking at the difference in patients in terms of their, you know, outcome, I'm sorry, in terms of how they presented based on the kind of mutation that they had. And so if the patient had what we call a nonsense mutation, the S338X mutation that you saw earlier from Dr. Gobrill, these are the kind of patients that are more likely than not to come in with hyperviscosity crisis. Whereas the other kind of mutations that we call frameshift mutations, and frameshift mutations are actually different. A mutation gets introduced into the gene, which kind of throws off the tracks, but you still have the ability to read, you know, the gene. you know, those are less threatening than the nonsense mutations, where the mutation causes the tail, the CXCR4 tail, to be cut off altogether and function very differently. And, you know, the kind of information that's come out of these kinds of, you know, modeling in our laboratory tells us that the failure that occurs, and I'm going to jump right to this slide, the failure that occurs because of the CXCR4 mutation is that, you know, you end up with a permanent on switch where the CXCR4 receptor stays on the cell surface and it continuously receives these signals from SDF1, which is the protein that binds to the receptor and turns on these very important growth and survival factors called AKT and ERK. And so that's the problem, is that for many patients with Waldenstrom's, the switch gets broken because of the mutation, the antenna stays up, it receives these signals, and it consistently gives these signals to the cell that say, grow and survive, do not die. And that's why we end up with this accumulation of Waldenstrom cells in the bone marrow. The good news is that, you know, there are ways to subvert this kind of pathway. And Dr. Gobriel mentioned at least one drug. There's quite a few others as well that are, you know, important drugs. And so this is actually one of the models that was created in our laboratory by Dr. Yang Cao, who reported her work at the American Society of Hematology last year. But she was able to show that if you had this mutation, you became resistant to ibrutinib. And if you use a drug called AMD-3100, which is an FDA-approved drug that we use in patients with lymphoma to mobilize their cells for stem cell harvesting, you could actually reverse that phenotype and, in fact, resensitize those cells, you know, to die in the presence of ibrutinib. Now, this is actually the clinical evidence to show you that the CXCR4 mutation actually makes a difference when you're being treated with ibrutinib. And so these were prepared by Zach Hunter for me, and what they show you is what happens to the IgM levels serially as the patients get treated, you know, throughout their cycles. Every cycle is 1 month, and whether, you know, and what happens whether you have the WHIM mutation or not. And you can see there's less decrease in the IgM if you have the WHIM mutation, and even more importantly, less improvement in hemoglobin as you would expect. So, in fact, having the WHIM mutation, the CXCR4 WHIM mutation, you know, decreases your likelihood of response to ibrutinib. And this is very nicely summarized here, where you see what the major response rates in patients with CXCR4 WHIM are. It's about 30%, whereas those that have no mutation, it was about 80%. And so, you know, the impetus from this kind of data is to allow us to be able to create clinical trials which can overcome this limitation. And one of the drugs that we can, you know, we're looking forward to doing this with is the drug AMD-3100, which is also known as plerixafor. And this is an FDA-approved drug. You can give it subcutaneously. And in fact, just recently, the NIH just had a paper out where they were using this drug, you know, daily for patients that have WHIM mutations, and they were giving it for up to 6 months' time, and the tolerance was actually quite good. And so this trial, we hope, will be open later this year for patients that have the WHIM mutation. Now, what I also want to come back to in terms of why these Waldenstrom cells still are alive for many patients is that even though ibrutinib clobbers this BTK pathway that I showed you, it really has no effect on the IRAK pathway, which is the alternative pathway by which NF-kappa-B signaling can happen. And the proof for this is, in fact, the patient cells that we've taken from patients with Waldenstrom who have been on ibrutinib. And what you find is that IRAK remains on even though you've been able to shut off BTK in most of these cells. And so the kind of strategy that we're hoping to embark on is to try to now use IRAK inhibitors along with ibrutinib to be able to synergize and kill these cells off. And the very nice proof of that comes from the paper from Dr. Guang Yang, who did this work and published it in Blood, showing, in fact, that we can get synergy if we combine IRAK inhibitors along with ibrutinib. The other important advance that I also want to report on is the discovery that this other very important molecule called PI3 kinase delta is also turned on by MYD88. And in fact, the kind of tedious work that's now going on in our laboratory is to try to show exactly how MYD88 is able to turn this enzyme on. Now, why this is really important for us to know about, because it can also signal growth and survival pathways through the AKT pathway that I mentioned earlier. But also, more importantly, there's a drug for this that's very advanced in clinical trial. And in fact, that drug is called idelalisib. I dare you each to try to pronounce this very fast and repeat it over and over again. It took me forever. But it's a very selective inhibitor of PI3 kinase delta. And this also has moved now into very advanced trials in patients with various B-cell diseases. Now, this is actually a study by my friend A.J. Gopal up in Seattle, who published in the New England Journal of Medicine this year the outcome of this drug. It's an oral inhibitor as well. In patients with various diseases, including Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia, they had 10 patients with relapsed refractory disease that got this drug, and in fact, 70% of those patients, had a response to the drug, and they were quite, well tolerated, and they were very impressed with their results. And so, given these findings, this is a clinical trial that we will be opening up at our institution. This will also probably be opening up at Memorial Sloan as well as at Stanford, but it will be a phase 2 study of idelalisib in relapsed refractory patients, and the dosing for that is 150 milligrams twice a day. Now, we're excited about this drug because not only does it have potential as a single agent, but also, again, looking at the kind of modeling that we've done with this drug in our laboratory, you can actually show that you can synergize between ibrutinib and idelalisib and show selective and enhance tumor cell killing when these two inhibitors are combined. And this, of course, makes sense because MYD88 is able to switch on a lot of switches, and being able to turn those off will inevitably require more than one inhibitor, i.e. that of ibrutinib. The last comments that I just want to make involve, the individuals that don't have the MYD88 mutation. And those individuals are known as wild type. So wild type means that there's no mutation in MYD88. This has been a very concerning, group for us because the behavior of these patients is very different. When you look at, the actual mutation profile, there are actually mutations present in the cells of these patients that we don't find in those that have the MYD88 L265P mutation. Notably, mutations in the MLL2 gene we were able to find. And interestingly, the MLL2 gene is mutated in other lymphomas, like follicular lymphoma. 90% of those patients have that mutation. In aggressive lymphoma, about a third of those patients have, this mutation. And why this is important is because when we looked at the overall survival of patients with and without the MYD88 mutation, with and without CXCR4 mutations, the outcome was actually quite surprising. Having a WHIM mutation, a CXCR4 mutation, really didn't change overall survival. But on the other hand, if the patients had wild-type MYD88, meaning they didn't have a mutation, and that's the 5% of all Waldenstrom's patients that I described earlier, then survival for those patients was significantly lower. And this is why I think as an IWMF, objective, we really need to understand better, this MYD88 wild-type disease, because it confers a poor prognostic outcome. And these are the kind of patients that I think we really need to owe up to in terms of better understanding their disease to be able to make also directed therapies for them. So to summarize, the MYD88 mutation, L265P, is present in greater than 90% of patients with Waldenstrom's. It triggers the IRAK pathway, but it also triggers the Bruton's tyrosine kinase pathway. The BTK inhibitor ibrutinib is very active, as you've seen, with improvements in serum IgM and hematocrit, and very good response rates in the relapsed refractory patients. The CXCR4 status impacts both serum IgM and hemoglobin levels, as well as the ability to get those good responses. And the inhibitors to both MYD88 and CXCR4 pathways represent novel approaches to treating Waldenstrom's either alone or in combination. I think it's really important to try to give credit where credit is due, and these are all the individuals that have helped play role in the discovery of these mutations, as well as the conduct of the clinical trials. Zach Hunter at our institution, Ranjana Advani, Leah Palumba. Ranjana is at Stanford, and some of you may know her, and Leah Palumba is at Memorial. And of course, none of this would have been possible if we didn't have the support from some great people. The IWMF has been foremost in providing support for the Whole Genome Project, as well as Dr. Peter Bing and many other foundations that have helped support these developments. And, of course, I also want to acknowledge, you know, the home team, the Bing Center for Waldenstrom's. Dr. Castillo, who you see over here, and nurse practitioner Kanan actually have taken over my clinic. And I have to tell you, patients actually have been quite happy with the transition. They understand why I've had to do what I've had to do. But on the other hand, truly this has been seamless. And I still play a very active role in the clinic. I sit with the team every week. We spend up to 4 hours going through every patient line by line, making sure that we really have a team effort in caring for the patients that we've been privileged to see. Over 1,000, as Mike was telling you, come and go every year to the Waldenstrom Center. And if you're interested in knowing more about the Bing Center, there's the website. And of course, at your disposal for any questions, including consults, Chris Patterson is always available. In my last just slides here, I also just wanted to thank the IWMF, you know, for not only being there to help support, you know, the clinical efforts, the basic science efforts, but also the workshop to Waldenstrom's. The next one will be coming up this August. It'll be held in London. We've been privileged to actually be given the House of Parliament for our closing ceremonies. It is a wonderful and quite a great honor, but I think it really represents the global effort that has gone into this disease. And in closing here, I just want to reflect on, you know, I've been spending a lot of time in England now, you know, getting ready for this meeting. And of course, you know, one of my heroes has been, I'm sure for many of you as well, has been Winston Churchill. But when it comes to understanding really the prerogatives, the steadfast dedication, you know, that the IWMF has given to this disease, I think it's very well summarized in these infamous words by Winston Churchill. And I know that just as he never surrendered, neither will the IWMF. And with that, I'll conclude, and thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you, Dr. Treon. I'm sure we have questions for Dr. Treon. I'll start over here.
Is the ibrutinib available, or is that still in the testing stage as a drug?
No, ibrutinib is now FDA approved for CLL as well as mantle cell lymphoma, and has now been added, because it is approved in other diseases, it's now been added to the NCCN guidelines. The NCCN is actually an organization that Medicare and many insurers go by, and so based on, you know, evidence that it, you know, clinical evidence that exists, and most notably if clinical trials have been done in other diseases, the NCCN has the prerogative that can actually add another disease to a particular approved drug. And so it is now approved and accessible, you know, under this mechanism.
Sad news that the bone marrow testing might be antique. What will it be replaced by?
Well, peripheral blood testing. You know, the ability to go in and give some of your blood and allow then a molecular, you know, workup to be done of that blood. And I want to tell you, that kind of approach is now happening in many other hematological malignancies. You know, CML, we use the BCR-ABLE translocation. You know, we look at JAK mutations for those patients that have polycythemia vera. You can do that with a simple blood test. Now, I will put also the challenge out to the IWMF. There is really some very nice advanced techniques now to be able to do this without needing to do B-cell isolations. The biggest problem that we face is that, you know, clinical laboratories have to get this work done fast. I mean, if you think about it, thousands of patients knocking on your door every day giving blood, you need to be able to have testing that can be done very rapidly. And there are now ways, you know, and equipment that you can use where you don't have to even, you know, slow down and select out those B cells. You can actually, you know, have that done in a very, you know, quick time frame, and also to look at multiple mutations, not just the MYD88, because as I've shown you earlier, there's probably going to be more to this story, and our ability to be able to get a better picture for a patient will come by understanding, you know, the different types of mutations that a patient may present with. Please.
Two quick questions. Well, one quick and one maybe not so quick, but Are the genomic tests that you're describing generally available now, or are these, is this just experimental? And second question, for many years you've talked about Waldenstrom's, turning Waldenstrom's into a chronic disease, and now we're hearing talk of a cure. Is that justified, and what will that look like?
Well, I think the importance of, you know, putting historically things into perspective, you know, cure is dying of something other than the disease that, you know, that you're under treatment for. So, I mean, as we're seeing here more and more evidence of that, you know, that's happening. And let me also focus on one other point, which I, you know, I think there's more and more of these examples, is when now we can treat patients, you know, that have this disease, and to get now to a complete remission and not even be able in many of these patients to find the MYD88 mutation anymore, even by having the most sensitive technology put to hand. So it's telling us we're getting into these so-called molecular complete remissions, something that we couldn't have even imagined, you know, even I think 2 or 3 years ago. We finally have more of these, and we're starting to report them in our clinical trials. So I think we're moving there. There are cures that are happening. You know, those numbers have to increase, of course. But these new drugs, the targeted drugs, really, you know, provide us really with the best hope ever, you know, now knowing the signaling pathway and the mutations behind them to getting at that. And I think, you know, President Harrington's, you know, imagine the cure is more than imagination, it's real. The second point that, you know, coming back to your first question is about testing and being able to do this. So the MYD88 test now is commercially available. Many laboratories offer it. Probably the most common one vendor is Quest Diagnostics. They offer it. NeoGenomics offers it. There's a couple of others. And I think, you know, many of the major hospitals now also offer it. So it became adopted very quickly. It's on the NCCN guidelines, which means that most insurers now can cover it as well. So be aware of that. Now, CXCR4 is a little bit more different because it's going to be a little more tedious. This is actually a mutation which, as I showed you a second ago, it isn't explained by just one single point mutation. So using PCR technique like we've done for MYD88 may help address, you know, up to half of patients, you know, who may have the mutation, but all the other mutations that we found will be better addressed through a technique called Sanger sequencing, which is you actually want to sequence the entire tail of the CXCR4 gene from the tumor cells. And so that kind of technology is evolving. In fact, at our institution, hopefully the rollout will happen later this month, but there is something called MI-seq, which now allows us to be able to do this in a clinical reproducible manner. And so I know at our institution it'll be available. I'm hoping that it will also become a commercial way that, you know, others can also start, you know, testing wholesale for CXCR4. You know, to the great credit of, you know, everyone involved in this effort, this is the first time that a mutation in CXCR4 has been described in any cancer. Think about it, in any cancer. I mean, we're in the lead here genomically for the first time.
The room.
Thank you, Dr. Treon. As genome testing becomes more available and less expensive, do you foresee beyond the cure prevention?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think, you know, that's Carl Harrington's theme for next year. So, you know, this is the kind of thing that we dream of, is being able to, you know, head these diseases off at the pass. And I think, you know, some of the questions that were vetted earlier during Dr. Gobriel's, you know, presentation are important. You know, once we understand, you know, what the predisposing, you know, lesions are, there is this opportunity to intervene. We, in fact, have proposed a trial where we actually would try to intervene at the smoldering Waldenstrom stage, because there, at least based on the wonderful work that Bob Kyle had done, you have a better sense of that progression. It's about 10%, you know, per year, and about 5 years later, half the patients will have gone from smoldering to symptomatic disease. And so being able to intervene in, you know, that kind of scenario, you know, may be, you know, a little bit more clinically acceptable, because, you know what you know, the defined rate of conversion is from, you know, being smoldering to symptomatic. But in doing so, I just want you to think for just one second. The trial that we had proposed was with ibrutinib. And I'm not sure if many of you know how much ibrutinib costs. And maybe some of you do know. It's about $150,000 a year. So, you know, think about the cost, you know, in a five-year trial, you know, five times 150, that's a lot of college tuition. But we're talking about just, you know, for the privilege of being able to prevent disease, not treat disease. And so these are the kind of things that really need to be, you know, prognosticated better. For IGM-MGUS, I think it's a very hard argument to even, you know, conceptualize at this point, you know, considering that the conversion rate, and again, based on the excellent work that Dr. Kyle, you know, gave us, is about 2, maybe 2.5% per year, so far less, you know, even there. And, you know, maybe here we can understand, you know, who the folks are that are more likely to convert if they have the MYD88 mutation, as the Italian study shows, you know, and target them. But again, you know, the cost-benefit analysis is really one that you'd have to take very seriously.
Thanks, Dr. Treon. I asked Dr. Ansel this morning a question, and he threw a lateral pass to you. He indicated that the reactions to Rituxan were pretty unique with WM. So my question was, do you have any theories as to why this is true?
So I'm not sure which reaction you may be referring to, but I'm going to take a shot that it's probably the IgM flare that you're referring to. Is that correct? It's the whole scope of things. Well, that's a very complicated question. But I will say that, you know, we did model in our laboratory why the IgM flare may occur. And, you know, very early on, you know, we did very primitive experiments. Take Waldenstrom cells, add Rituxan, and look. You know, and there was no IgM. You know, they didn't make any IgM, and we were a little bit baffled by that. And then came along an interesting observation. We gave a couple of patients IVIG because they were having recurring infections, and those patients had a flare. And so all of a sudden we started saying to ourselves, well, maybe this has nothing to do with the CD20-directed portion of the Rituxan molecule, and it has to do with the other end. The other end is called the Fc domain. And IVIG and Rituxan have the same Fc domain. And so as we began to model that, we realized that what was happening there is various immune cells that are so-called bystander cells, macrophages are probably the most important ones, that live in the same neighborhood as the Waldenstrom cells. Once they see Rituxan or IVIG, they're the ones that are actually shooting off, you know, interleukin-6 that then causes the IgM to be made by the Waldenstrom cells. So it's really a bystander effect that's mediated by interleukin-6, and that's because the neighborhood is starting to scream, you know, when Rituxan is given.
Dr. Treon, what would determine if you used ibrutinib as a first line of treatment?
Yeah, that's a great question, Harry. Unfortunately, you know, being able to come up with a logical algorithm today when we don't even have a trial yet, you know, would be a little bit hard to go out on the limb and discuss. But I think, you know, the experience that we've had with ibrutinib in the relapsed refractory setting has left us in many ways gratified. You know, one, by seeing a very favorable toxicity profile, two, by seeing really rapid reductions in IgM. So if you have somebody who's come in with hyperviscosity crisis, you know, it makes it easier. You give them the pills, and, you know, you maybe have to ferrate them, because if they're in an emergent situation, you may have to do ferresis, but you're more likely to get that IgM down and get it down consistently. And you tend to avoid some of the pitfalls that we've seen with some of the drug therapies that we currently use, the neuropathy with Velcade. It's a big problem. You know, secondary cancers with nucleoside analogs, fludarabine, you know, we saw a lot of patients develop secondary cancers. And so this is why it's important to look at these new drugs as, you know, an opportunity to not only get very effective targeted therapy, but avoid also the pitfalls of some of the, you know, side effects that we've seen with many of the common drugs that we use today.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Treon.
Thank you.